The afternoon of January 16, 1939, two of the most famous scientists in the world visited a remote mansion outside New York City. Hidden inside was a world-class laboratory, the consuming passion of a secretive millionaire.
Within the scientific community, there were tales of this mysterious hilltop laboratory, fabulously equipped, owned and operated by this millionaire who moved in the background like a shadow. And you couldn't just get in, but if you were a top flight talent, the invitation would come from Alfred Loomis.
Physicists Niels Bohr and Enrico Fermi brought staggering news. That afternoon, Alfred Loomis became one of the first people to learn that scientists had split the atom in a process that transformed mass into energy, potentially huge amounts of energy. Nobody knew the answer to the critical question: could this be used to build an unimaginably powerful bomb? Under any circumstances, the prospect would have been unsettling. Under these circumstances, it was terrifying. Nuclear fission had been discovered in Hitler's Germany. For years, Loomis had been hearing rumors of the work going on in German labs. Jet engines, tanks, artillery, synthetic fuels, ballistic missiles, and now nuclear fission. With every discovery, Hitler was growing more dangerous. Bohr and Fermi left Tuxedo Park the next morning. Alone in his mansion, Loomis decided to pursue what must have seemed a forlorn hope. He would dedicate himself to overcoming Germany's scientific advantage. It was an implausible notion, but it would change Loomis's life and, against all odds, alter the course of history.
I remember first learning about Loomis and just being blown away. I'm like, what? This thing happened and nobody knows about it?
Alfred Loomis didn't start out reclusive, a millionaire, or even a scientist. In fact, he had tried hard to live an unremarkable life. After graduating from Harvard in 1912, he took a job as a corporate lawyer on Wall Street, made a good marriage, started a family, and settled in the village of Tuxedo Park, 40 miles outside Manhattan. On the surface, there was little that distinguished Loomis from any number of his well-bred peers. But behind the polished facade was a raw, unformed ambition and a most unusual mind. Alfred's rigid propriety was in fact a penance, the legacy of his father's transgressions.
Everyone knew that his father was unfaithful. Everyone knew that he drank too much. His parents' marriage was miserable. And so Alfred had this sort of rootless, parentless existence, and he felt the shame of his father's behavior hanging over him.
Growing up in an emotional void, Alfred found solace in scientific exploration. He was captivated by life's mysteries, the smallest increments of time, prime numbers, black holes. The pursuit of the unknown offered an escape, but only for a time. The family's troubles culminated when Alfred's father died suddenly, leaving the young man responsible for his mother and sister.
The family had name and stature, but they didn't have money. Alfred wanted to make sure his sister and his mother would be okay, so he had to enter a profession, earn money and make up for in wealth and respectability what his father had not bequeathed them.
Alfred's marriage was the perfect expression of his rectitude.
Oh, my Lord, my grandmother, Ellen Farnsworth Loomis, was beautiful. I mean, she was called the most beautiful girl in Boston.
They were very, very active. I don't think they had a quiet moment. It was the one time that I think they were both incredibly happy and had a lovely marriage.
Alfred and Ellen played tennis and golf, attended soirees, and were praised in the social columns. Despite Alfred's determination to fit in, there were things that set him apart.
I have seen Alfred take on my father, a very good chess player, and two other scientists, good chess players. He was playing all three of them simultaneously. He was looking away from it, possibly on the telephone in another room, and the moves were called out to him. Alfred would nod his head and then reply what his move was. Alfred never lost.
There were other signs that there was more to Alfred Loomis than met the eye. In his off hours, he applied for patents on various small devices he had invented, ranging from a slide rule for calculating securities to a reliable fire extinguisher. For 5 years, Loomis bridled his restless mind at Tuxedo Park. Then, in 1917, he got a reprieve when the United States went to war with Germany. He trained as an officer, and with the help of an influential cousin, was posted to the Army's Research Center near Aberdeen, Maryland.
For Alfred Loomis, this is like heaven, being able to invent things, having a real impact. This is a whole intoxicating new world to him.
He comes up with a device to measure muzzle velocities much more accurately than any other existing device. Accurate muzzle velocity means more accuracy hitting at targets. And the fact that Loomis actually improves the accuracy of the major weapon of the First World War is quite an extraordinary accomplishment for someone who was in fact a lawyer.
When the war ended in 1918, Alfred returned to his old law firm. He needed the income. He had a wife and three sons to support now, as well as his mother and sister. But at Aberdeen, he had glimpsed a different, irresistible future. His ambition had crystallized.
The world was exploding with new science. It's as if the whole world of science went from black and white to technicolor, and Alfred wanted to be part of it.
For Loomis, the prospect of a lifetime's worth of soirees, socializing, and corporate law had become unbearable. If he was going to avoid that fate, Loomis would have to make enough money to get out from under his obligations.